Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the TCID webinar. My name is Brian Childs. I'm a senior business analyst here at Railinc. And this afternoon, we're going to go over a demonstration of TCID. So the agenda for today's call. We'll go over the TCID background and talk about some of the planned releases. We're going to go over TCID setup, where I'm going to hit all the roles that we have set up for our single sign-on and those permissions, and then how users and company are set up to work. Then we're going to go over the TCID application, and we're really going to hit every screen in the TCID application. We're going to go over the inspections and how batch upload works, what email notifications look like, the view inspection screen and how we've made some slight changes to that, creating a new inspection, and then we're going to hit the three reports that the application offers. We'll go over help and documentation. So some background about TCID. The Tanker Integrated Database, that's an application that's been hosted for, four or five years now. And it's a database of inspections, repairs, and alterations. And it was created to enable tank car owners to comply with AAR regulations. And the initial application was created by SIMS professionals and engineers, and they've been doing a fantastic job. Safety and Research Committee decided to move the application over to Railinc to leverage Railinc's Umbler database, our standard data sources, and we just have a lot more of the industry products that we can leverage to enhance, get the future enhancements that the car owners are looking for. That's why the decision was made. So for 2018, the scope of the work was to move the application from SIMS to Railinc. That was moving the database, the application, and the documentation. A lot of the documentation we had to do, we created new. Looking forward towards 2019, we're calling it phase two. There's a couple of different areas that the technical advisory group is looking into, the TAG. They're looking to maybe integrate it with EIN, provide a dashboard for AAR, people to be able to see across companies. There's some reports and filtering that we can put in to enhance that are pretty easy to do, and I think we're looking to do some of those things. The TAG is continuing. We meet bi-weekly, and we have a full agenda, and we go over issues that I hear from customers and new requests from the industry. Moving forward, we're going to follow more of the Umbler docket process and how tank car change requests will be handled. Basically, not just taking a request as we receive it and enabling it, but a more considered approach where we fill out a docket and the TAG reviews it, and then that's brought forth to the tank car committee. And we, Railinc, will continue following the notice of implementation to provide users advance warning of the changes. That's right out on railinc.com. We have a couple of releases planned in the next few months. The first one is, these first two are actually finishing up what is really probably should have been included with phase one. What we did is we are right now, and I'm going to go over this today in the demo. If you submit a file and it has some inaccurate data and it's of certain fields, we are accepting it. We are accepting the submission and letting users know that there's a warning on the field, meaning the data did not comply. And so these releases that we're talking about are actually changing these warnings, which allow the submission of the file to come in where we drop the data. We're changing that to errors, so the files will not be submitted. And then towards the end of the second quarter, we will remove the rest of those warnings, and it will be full errors. So we have a full, robust TCID system with data validations. We had implemented this change working with a TAG. We found during user acceptance testing, when people were using their production files and they were submitting them to Railinc, they encountered errors and their files were not accepted. So they were coming to me and asking why weren't these files accepted. And it turned out that if someone was in the SIM system and they entered an inspection or any sort of repair online, those all went perfectly and they followed all the data validations. But if they submitted the data through the batch upload UI or an FTP upload, they were allowing inaccurate data to come into the system. So So the tag saw that information and decided we'll go ahead and we'll just implement what we can right now. And you can see we have a staggered release where these warnings will be changed to error messages. And then the more complex ones will be changed to error messages. And we're allowing a little over 90 days between each change. And one additional thing that I'll note is when these changes are available, they'll be in our test environment, so users can test with them as long as they're set up in our pre-production environment, and that way they should be able to know how things are going to work for them when we switch over to production. So to view requests, to view permissions for the TCID application, there are four roles, and I'm going to go over each of those roles and talk about the role description and what the permissions are. So the first role we'll talk about is the AAR member. And AAR member can see across all companies. They're viewing data. They don't care about company specific. They're looking at the health of the fleet. So that member views across all companies. They can view data, but they cannot submit any data. Very few people will have this role. We're talking about like two or three people from the AAR will get this role. A company administrator is the role that's responsible for granting permissions on behalf of their company. This role does not allow any sort of interaction with the application. It is strictly granting or declining permissions to the application. Because this role doesn't have any interaction with the application, we suggest that this is typically included with a tank car owner delegate or even a facility user. The owner delegate role is really probably the most robust role in the application, and that's where a user is working on behalf of a company. And they have full access to all the inspections that the company has. They can see the open inspections. They can see all the submitted inspections. They can view data. They can view reports for their company or for the company that they have permissions on behalf of. A facility user is a more limited role. A facility user is someone that has access to the application, but only has access to the submissions that they've submitted, the inspections they've submitted, so they can view and input their own data versus the company, the owner delegate will be able to see the facility user. The facility user will only be able to see what they put in. I've got an example here of how a third-party vendor could work. A third-party vendor would be working on behalf of another company. So the third-party vendor would they're creating or using existing SSO, that's a single sign-on ID, basically a Railinc user ID. And the vendor would request TCID facility user access for the companies they'll work on behalf of. Then the company administrator for those companies would approve or decline those requests. And once approved, the third-party vendor, as a facility that got approved for that company, they should be able to submit on behalf of those companies, that company or more. And the owner delegate will see those submissions. So you get to see your inspections that were at SIMS. If you're not seeing them now when you're at Railinc, that's because there's a mapping process that we need to do. So in the past, we at SIMS, there was about 85,000 inspections, and we knew the SIMS, you know, the SIMS username, which are email addresses. We know which inspections these users submitted. We know what company they were representing, but we don't know who they are in Railinc. So this initial mapping we have to do is, when people request access, and we've sent this in our email that we'd like you to have put in your SIMS user ID, which is your SIMS, whatever SIMS email address you're using for that user, if you link that to your Railinc ID, we will be able to find your old inspections, link them, and then they will be visible in Railinc's TCID system. Some other parts of setup that you need, if you want to do FTP, you contact Railinc at CSC, that's our Customer Success Center, and they can help with the FTP mailbox. For companies with an existing FTP mailbox, again, they'll contact CSC, and we will add the TCID subscription so they can submit via FTP. To receive an email notification on FTP submission, the user will need to be set up in findus.rail as a contact, and they would need to have the TCID category. So basically what ends up happening is if you're set up at findus.rail and you have an FTP, when you upload your file via FTP, it goes out and sees everyone that's a contact on behalf of that company, and they get an email notification on the FTP submission. And the TCID application on the launch pad, once you're granted access, this is what it looks like. It appears in your applications, and these are in alphabetical order. We purposely put the tanker integrated database in alphabetical order with the certificate of construction. I'd like to point out that all these screenshots you're going to see are from our test environment. So you'll see the URL has www.tst.railinc. And you'll see that everything that I have is false data. I'm going in as company Rail, which is Railinc's company. And all the data that you'll be seeing today is all made up data. We just put it in through tests. It is not live data. So you will see some things that may not make sense because as testers, they've just entered in data. As you get into the home screen, there's a couple things you should notice that your Railinc single sign-on ID is up over here on the top menu. And if you have access to multiple companies for that, for your ID, you'll see them in the pull-down. And this is a change from what we had at Sims. At Sims, users used to have to log out and log back in with a different user ID to represent different companies. Here, a user can log in once, and then they can be working, and they can select a different company. You'll get a window prompting, you know, are you sure you want to leave this screen? And then you'll go and represent the other company. On the inspection screen, we have three screens: new inspection, view inspections, and batch upload. For batch upload, it should look very similar to if anyone has worked with the Sims application. This will look almost identical, maybe a little cleaner with the Railinc's user interface. But you choose a file. This opens up a browser window that the window that opens looks will change depending on which browser you're using. You search for the file. It'll show you CSV files, and then once you find the file you're looking for, you select it. You can see the full file name if you hover over those ellipses. A window should open up and show you what the full file name is, and then select upload file. Once you upload the file, then we give you a couple of status boxes. The first one that comes up is blue, saying that it recognizes that it's uploading the file, and then the green one pops up saying that it was successful, and I believe we get a red if it's a failure. After the logged in user has uploaded the file, they'll receive an email submission, and this should look pretty similar to what you had at Sims. We made a couple of changes, and I want to go over a couple, like three different scenarios of the emails you could receive. The first one is the most basic. It's a submission that we accepted. So if I talk about just the email itself, so all of our emails are going to start with TCID first, and then what you're looking at here. So here you're looking at the batch file submission report. Then over here on the top, we've included the file name itself with the extension. This is an additional functionality that we added in at Railinc to give users more of an idea when they're looking in their email address which file was submitted that may have passed or failed. As you get into the report, we repeat what the report is. The file name is there again, and then of course the whole date and timestamp is there in inverse order. And here we have a high level of view of what was done. So of the inspections, and this particular file that I used in my example, I submitted two inspections at the same time, and both those files were accepted. So again, this is the most basic scenario that I think people are going to see. The next scenario is rejected, where the file is not submitted. The format looks the same. The difference is on the inspections row, where you're seeing that you have two files rejected. And then below here, we see some details about what happened. You know, you have the inspection ID, which should help you when you get into your batch upload file if you want to find the row. We show the field name that had the error. And the field name is spelled out twice, as you see here. The field name, the first part of this is the field name as it appears in the application. And in brackets, all capitals, this is the field name as it appears in the batch upload file. And I did this because I found it was difficult when we were trying to make sure that these names link, because they are not always logical. So this gives you two different ways. And actually, if you're trying to troubleshoot the file, if you double click and copy this and you can get into your file and try to find it, you can find the column. Field value is the actual data that was submitted. And then of course that this is an error, and then your error message. So something else we're doing, we're including the data that was submitted as we have it. Sometimes you'll see null if it's a blank field and maybe it was required. The third scenario is new. This scenario is accepted with warnings. And this is what I was talking about in the beginning when I talked about some of the upcoming releases and the functionality that we have now. We were intending on adding this functionality in 2019, but we needed to add it in sooner to get production files coming in and being accepted by the system. So what this is saying is that we have two inspections, and both of them accepted, but there are warnings. Below here, you can see the warning. So again, all the same information as before, the data that was entered, but here you see it's a warning. And what we're doing with these warnings is, if it's a warning, we are dropping that data because that's inaccurate data. We are keeping the main part of the field, that the file that's correct. Those are the required fields. What this says to me when I look at this is that all the required fields of this file were correct and valid and accepted. These fields that were more considered optional, we're dropping off, and we're going to keep the main part of the inspection. The benefit to the user is they can, of course, get back into their upload file. They can correct the data, re-upload it, and then see if it works, and they can delete the old inspection. Or, as I'll show you in a little while here, you can get into the inspection itself and edit it, and then go ahead and submit it again. From the last webinar, I included a couple of links on this one, and this is a link to the data specification manual and the data dependencies matrix. And as I'll cover again, all of our documentation is on railinc.com. So the other screens in inspection, view inspection. This should look very similar to what you saw in Sims. You have equipment initial, number, the builder, miles, inspection date, modified date. We also have the column status, actions, and report. And what I wanted to point out on this screen is the columns status and actions. These are slight changes from what we had before in Sims. So the status column shows three different statuses: open, reopen, and submitted. And this is important to note because in Sims, the inspection screen was called view open inspections. We didn't think that really made much sense for users that may want to view their, you know, submitted inspections. And through testing with the tag, we had, you know, open and submitted inspections available. And when we talked about removing it to match Sims, the tag talked about how they'd like to be able to see a inspection they had recently submitted without having to go to the reports tab and go and actually enter in the equipment initial and number to pull it, or to pull a different report to see it. So they thought it wasn't too big of a change to include this new functionality with this release. To keep it similar to Sims, we forced the sort order, the default sort order of the screen, to open inspections first, and then reopen, and then submit it. Reopen is a new status that was added with the tag. So we can have a submitted inspection, and then if you unsubmit the inspection, it becomes reopened. And they wanted to make sure that the user understood that this was a previously submitted, a reopened inspection is an inspection that was previously submitted and now it's open, available for editing again. And the actions on the side you see are edit and delete, and then view and unsubmit. The last of the inspection screen is new inspection screen. This is something that should look very similar to Sims. We have it cleaned up a little bit. We have user interface professionals that work here, and we defer to them for a lot of our standards. They have bolded and added a red wildcard to all the required fields so you can see them quickly. And we just kind of cleaned up the UI so it kind of reads nice and just kind of, it follows a logical tabbing order. This is the first section, what I call the main section of the new inspection. Once all this data is entered correctly, let me back up. And once data is entered here and the user selects next, if there's data that entered incorrectly at all, those fields will have a red error appear with what the error is, what's going on with the field. A lot of times it's required or there might be some small formatting thing. Once the user hits next, they'll get to the next section where we see the three sections: drawing, weld, and shell fill. They should look pretty similar, maybe cleaned up, but it should look very similar to what they had in Sims. And the actions that we have available at the bottom of the page are to close, in case the user wants to just go back to the view inspection screen, or save inspection and submit inspection. I want to take a second and walk through one of these. So saved inspections appear in the sort order as open, and submitted inspections appear in the inspections as submitted. which makes sense. But what we found, and Warren uses about, is if you're playing around on this screen and you go to submit application over here on the bottom right, and for if you're looking for it at the top of the screen, it's not going to be there. It's going to be in the top of your submitted inspections. That's just something to watch for. Once you use it for a while, I think you'll see it, but we did see people looking for that kind of stuff when they were testing it and forgetting that we have open and submitted inspections on the screen. If a viewer unsubmitted inspection, it looks a little differently. So all of the fields appear dithered. It's just showing the user the data. And as they scroll down, they can see their options. And on that one, they can close, make no changes, just go back to the view inspection screen. Unsubmit or delete the inspection. I'm going to pause quickly so I can review the questions. The questions we have are kind of along mapping, and I guess there's a couple different scenarios. When all the old inspections came over, they were basically all unassociated. We don't know who's the owner. We know who the company, and we know who the SIM submitter was, but we need to map them to their new Railinc ID or whatever their Railinc ID. So if a user has had old inspections and they want to see those things, that we can map from their old to their new. If they're part of a company and they've been given owner delegate access, they should see all the inspections on behalf of that company, regardless on if they actually were the ones who uploaded it or not. I hope this helps. The last thing I'll point out is that for inspections that will be mapped, you'll be able to see the submitted and opened. So if there was a couple inspections in draft status, those should appear. The reports tab. We have the three reports. These should look similar to what there was before. The UI should look almost identical. We didn't really change the text or anything. We have report name, the description, and then the input if it's needed, and then the icons that go along to actually kick off the process. For the inspection detail report, this is a detail on a single inspection. Similar to before, you enter the equipment initial and number, select the PDF icon, and a blue status box appears. Once complete, there's a PDF download which appears in the bottom of the browser window. Selecting the PDF should open in a new window. I'm showing over here. So here's my TCID application window. Here's the new window. This report should look kind of like the old SIMS report. We did make some changes. So we added a comment header, put in Railinc. We added a header that included a title. The other report didn't have a title. So again, this is the TCID tank car inspection detail report. And we're including the car initial and number. I thought it was weird when we looked at it. I couldn't tell quickly looking at an old report what the equipment initial and number was until I got down to the detail. So we tried to keep it right up on top, easy to see. We've added some bold text to kind of chunk the report out a little more logically. So we have the main section, and then each of the three sections has their own header area. I wanted to point out if no data was submitted in this area, then no data will appear. All we're doing is just showing the header there. The inspection summary report works very similarly, except this time all you have to do is click that PDF icon as a reminder of who will see what. An owner delegate will see all submitted inspections for their company, where the facility user will only see their own submitted inspections. Like the icon, you get the blue progress window opens up. PDF download appears. And again, selecting it opens in its brand new browser window. Here we have our third tab now. Similar to the inspection detail, the summary, we have our header, TCID inspection summary. This is the company I'm working on behalf of, so there it is, Rail. And this is a list of my submitted inspections, just very high level. So the service history by company report is a little different. Again, what the user will see will depend upon their access. Owner delegates are going to see all for their company. Facility users will see the ones they've submitted. So you select the Excel spreadsheet icon. This time we give you two windows, just like we do with a batch upload. You have the blue progress and the green success. For a successful report, the user, the logged in user, will receive an email. And it's very similar to the email we sent before. So again, the title is TCID, Service History by Company Report. And we have the name of the file we're sending, which you can see is Service History by Company, the company was reported for, and the date reversed. The body has very similar information. talking about the file that we're sending you and just what is in the file. This is a slight difference, though, right now between us and Sims. With Sims, the user would have also received an email, but it would have been an email stating your report is ready. Please log in and go to the reports page, and you have to kind of go out there and you find the report that you requested. Working with the tag, we gave them this option because we felt we could just go ahead and produce it that quickly, and they liked it. And then we asked if they found the need that they would ever go and use the historical reports, and they said that they would not. They could just pull in the reports and just query the data themselves. So this was where the decision was made to go with this report, where the user is receiving it right there in their inbox. Selecting the CSV file, opens Excel, and here's a partial file of what we're doing. And what we're doing here is we're basically dumping the data that was given to us back to the user. Okay, the only questions we're getting, I'm not sure I have a good answer for, but I thought I'd put them out here on the call. Our shop's now required to submit entries for all services related. I don't know the answer to that. I know the answer to TKID questions, the application, but not tank car industry questions. That's really a question for like a Matt Forrester or a Ken Dorsey. Let's see, is there a need to check to ensure the owned car equipment is in fact within the system? Again, I don't know about a need, and this application won't do that. You need to have right to view the inspection as all that this application is enabling the user for. Is there a flag or indicator that would tell the user if the same car number and date was entered prior by another party? That kind of gets into maybe tank car ownership or rights of who can see what. So for the who can see what, that part is coming next year with the EIN integration, and we've been working with the tag closely on, you know, when cars change hands. I don't think your question is specifically about that. Your question is more relevant to this application. Is there a flag to say that there is another piece, that there is a prior inspection or an additional inspection on this piece of equipment? And no, there is not. We don't have a flag like that. That's actually the first request we've heard of that. We've talked about different ways of viewing the data also. So, but right now, no, there is no flag. For duplicate paperwork, I understand. So the only thing that the user would be able to tell is if they went in and pulled the, I guess it would be the service history by company report and actually filtered on, you know, the equipment initial and number to see, you know, the duplicate entries, then they could go in and view the details of each one to see the dates. That's how you could do it. It's not easy, but it's not really that difficult, as long as you're a user that has access to those reports. As a facility, that would be more difficult because all you'd be seeing is what you as a facility had entered. But as a owner delegate, you would be able to see all inspections. So if you went out there and pulled that service history report, you would see all the inspections and could filter it down. So I'll go to the next slide here. You can see here. So this is the smallest section that we have here. The last tab is the help. And we're hitting documentation, notice of implementation, and templates. So when you select documentation, I should go back and show you. When you select the first one, documentation, that opens in a separate browser window, and all related documentation is on this one base page. We decided to group it, make it easy to find. So we have this one base page. You can drill down through products and services. There's a couple different ways you can find it, but once you get there, you can find all the related documentation. We moved everything that Sims had over here. We did not keep their old user guide and things like that because, although that is available in history if you go to NOIs, if you're looking to find how something used to work. But the links you see out here are our new documentations, our new user guide, which goes with our software, slightly updated data specification manual. Actually, that's not true. This is a lot updated data specification manual. And then we have an FAQ page we're going to continue to add information to. So notice of implementation, we also have as its own tab and templates. So just like I selected documentation, if I selected either of those, the notice of implementation page would actually open this one. And then if you did the tank car templates, that would open this one. It works. You don't need access to the application. All we're doing is just directing the user to where the help files are. Questions that weren't answered, or if you have additional questions, please submit them to our customer service center. This is the best way to get an answer. Going through customer service, we create a case, and that case is handled and tracked through our internal system, and it lets your question, it lets us know where the questions are, like, you know, maybe we're not doing a good enough job of explaining where new features should be, and also to make sure that we get back to you on your request. Thank you very much for attending today. I appreciate your attendance.